Welcome to Tapping Wisdom. I'm Sue Patternacht, and I'm delighted to introduce my colleague, Dr. Leonard Lane from the University of California, Irvine, who is a very well-renowned and, might I say, beloved strategy professor at the business school. So we've known each other for well over a decade, and he's been my role model in pursuing my own doctorate. So I've always appreciated your role modeling and your mentorship, Leonard. And one of the favorite lines that I learned from Leonard regarding strategy, I'm going to put this up in the camera, where to play and how to win. As you can see, I've scribbled this out and I have it right next to my desk all the time so that everybody remembers those lines from Leonard. Before I turn this over, I just wanted to let the audience know that we are on the eve of Veterans Day weekend, and I wanted to thank you for your service to our country. Maybe explain how your service to our country kind of informed some of the work that you do in strategy.
Okay, well, thank you, Sue, and it's a pleasure to join you on the program today. And yes, I'm very proud to be a United States Marine, and very, very proud to have served my country in the Marine Corps, and continue to support the veterans all over the world in all their endeavors today. As Sue said, I am a strategy professor at UCI. I'm kind of unique in a number of ways that I worked for approximately 40 years before I got my doctorate. And of that period of time, the majority of that time was overseas. A couple of interesting things, though, that that brought me to the position that I'm in, and Sue mentioned earlier, I have an undergraduate degree in political science with minors in international relations and macroeconomics. And then I got an MBA from USC and then my doctorate a few years ago from Case Western. What I found and what I'm going to lead to here was the learning process that I got as an undergrad really taught me to look at the complexity of the world that we are in. And that complexity I've been able to carry forward and work through the business world that I came into after an MBA and then worked for over 50 years in. And then the world that we found ourselves in now, where businesses are trying to figure out how to manage, lead, develop their ways through the very turbulence that we're in. And that leads me to what I'm going to talk about today, Sue. I want to talk about how we lead, how we learn, and how we innovate in the process of developing strategy in a turbulent world that I refer to as a whitewater world. And I want to share during the half hour we're together what I consider are the mindsets that we need, the tool sets that we need, and the type of organizational architecture that's going to be required to both develop and implement a strategy in what I call the whitewater world. And I'm going to go a little bit farther by saying, let me start by talking about what I mean by a whitewater world. And I want to go back to the past. And when I came into the business world, there was a world where our S curves, which we call the sigma curves of when we had major innovative breakthroughs, tended to be pretty stable over decades. And they were roughly 40 years apart. It took a while to get from steam to electricity, from electricity to the internet. All of these things over the 18th, 19th, and 20th century basically took time to get there. And there were eras of what we call relative stability. My parents and even myself, skills lasted a lifetime. Our career paths were very, very clear. And even up until now, scalable efficiency was the key. All of us in the manufacturing world I came out of went to Toyota. We learned how to scale. We learned about lean. But everything we learned about happened to be around efficiency. And then an incredible shift happened that we've all been in the middle of. And the shift is this. On the right-hand side, I'm basically showing that in the 20th century, the changes are being driven by a continual exponential advances in computation. And because of that, we are moving from a 20th century infrastructure that was stable over decades to a world where we are now seeing and perhaps more importantly, a rapid set of punctuated jumps for the next 20 to 40 years. Now, let me give you an example of what I mean by this that I talk about in my classes a lot, Sue. Take a look at the diagram on the right. Each one of those is an S curve. And where S curves used to be 20, 40, maybe 10 years apart, you're now looking at S curves that are basically showing up every 10 to 14 months apart. And here is a great example. Take out your iPhone or your Google phone or your Samsung phone. Take a look at that and ask yourself, how many new applications have I put on that? And I don't even want to call it a phone anymore. How many applications have I put on that platform? Because it's not just something you use to communicate with via phone. I can communicate via text. I can download apps. I can download videos. Every time you put something new on that screen, you are creating a new S-curve. And so think about how many times or how many apps you've put on that screen in the last year. Each one of those is an S-curve, and each one of those is basically a change. And so when I'm talking about a whitewater world, I want you to start by thinking about the 21st century infrastructure that is basically driven by computation, exponential computation, and speed of that computation, and think about now how fast all the changes we have are showing up in front of us. You know, from the Internet of Things to the Industrial Internet of Things to data mining to AI, all of those are now an integral part of our lives. And every time we make a breakthrough on one of those, it's a new S-curve. Now, that causes business problems for how do I reallocate my current assets to the threats that those cause by somebody else coming into my marketplace, to the opportunities they create for me because I happen to have the capabilities to take the leap to the next S-curve. Okay, so let me make sure that's really clear and go to the fact that these are basically saying the old best practices that we've been operating with for a significant period of time. Those practices are called yesterday's best practices, and they are rapidly becoming outmoded, literally every 12 to 14 months. Now, having made that statement, let me go on, because we've had another big shift. We used to live in a world of silos, where we have stocks of information that were protected, and we could deliver authoritative knowledge assets. And people basically said information is power. And so they kept the information themselves. And you've all worked in organizations where you've said, if I only knew what they were doing next door, I could have solved that problem. Why didn't they tell me? How come they're kind of after my job? How come they're after my business? All those things that we called in the old days, which was actually only a few years ago, scalable efficiency. What we've now gotten is where we basically have knowledge that is all over the world. We are hyper-connected. I'll talk about everything being connected. And what we want to learn how to do now is what I call participating in the knowledge flows. And by participating in the knowledge flows, and I'll talk about beyond connecting the dots, but developing new dots, we're now into a world where, in a networked world that we're in, the winning companies are the ones that basically learn the fastest. And if the winning companies are the ones that learn the fastest, I'm moving from scalable efficiency to scalable learning. And I want us to really keep that in mind as I go through the rest of my presentation. And so when I think about moving from scalable efficiency to scalable learning, I want you to kind of look at these two pictures, okay? These two pictures are basically two different eras, and they engendered quite different ways of working and learning. So if we take a look at the picture on the left, as we move the large ocean going, you know, the large ocean liner, what was the ocean liner doing? It was basically had a lot of engines buried in it, and they were powering through whatever got in front of them. Now, of course, the Titanic didn't quite power through that well, but nonetheless, the point here is what we did is I just put more and more and more power in the hull, and that power enabled me to go faster. and it enabled me basically to get to what we call scalable efficiency. But that only lasted until the internet came along. And now the internet comes along and I don't need all those heavy assets. And I don't need all the heavy assets. So in my organization, because I'm part of the network and because I can connect, I'm kind of more like in the digital age, the sailboat. I can now learn how to sail with the wind. I can now be very maneuverable. I can be much more agile. All the terms we use across business to talk about how to adapt very quickly to the changing environment. And as you can see in the scale, for those of you that are sailors, it's something that we learn how to do fairly well. But let me take you to another way to look at this. And as I want to take another way to look at this, I'm going to basically going from a digital age, which you are saying that now I'm in, I'm saying that we are now in what I call a whitewater age. We have something much more extreme than just digital. We have deep learning algorithms. We have reinforcement learning. We have secure cloud computing. I have new algorithms. I have blockchain. I have IoT. I have 5G. And I have a whole new set of institutional and strategic architectures. Now, what do I want those institutional and strategic architectures to do? And what do I want them to be aware of? And how do I really make them successful? Well, we are now in what I call a whitewater world. And in order to be successful, those institutional and architectural solutions that we have put together, connected by the internet, connected by stocks of knowledge, we have to understand that this world is increasingly fast. Things are happening, as you just know, in front of us today. We have a war going on in Israel that came upon us in the last 30 days. In addition to that war in Israel, as I take a look at my data flows today, I'm looking at even 31 additional conflicts around the world that are not much even visible. But at the same time, I'm getting breakthroughs in medical technology. I'm getting breakthroughs in communications. All of these are happening extremely fast. But the other part about this world is, and this is the importance of the whitewater world, these things are radically contingent and they're hyper-connected. And that means they're contingent one upon the other and they're connected. And when I play with one, another's going to move. So when I think about the World Economic Forum, and every one of you listening to this in one form or another in your businesses are managing risk. Well, I take a look at the different kinds of risks, the risks that are out 2 years and the risks that are out 10 years. Well, in the next 2 years, we have a cost of living crisis. I'm just going down a few of them: geoeconomic confrontation, erosion of social cohesion, widespread cybercrime and cybersecurity. Do they look kind of familiar? and then I take a look at 10 years out, and I can kind of have a lot of the same things that are still going on. I just haven't solved some of those. And they are in the economic area, the environmental area, the geopolitical area, the social area, and the technological area. And you can say, yeah, well, Leonard, you know, yeah, I understand all of those, but you said they're hyper-connected and they're radically contingent. Well, what do you mean? Well, let me take you to the next slide, which is also from the World Economic Forum. And this is something that I spend a lot of time with my students and with the clients I work with and the people that I advise, is I want them to understand that everything is connected, but not only connected, but entangled. Because I do a lot of work in supply chain, almost every one of these things in one form or another are impacting my ability of my supply chain to operate at an optimal condition. So let's take a look at a couple of these things together. When I take a look at, we call it collapse of a systemically important supply chain. Well, why did it collapse? Well, it might have collapsed because geoeconomic confrontation. It might have collapsed, you know, because we had a proliferation of illicit economic activity. It might have collapsed because we had a prolonged economic downturn. It might have collapsed because I had a cost of living crisis. It might have collapsed because I had a state collapse. It might have collapsed because I had environmental damage incidents. So if you take a look at this, I hope that your mind is spinning right now. And I hope that you're saying, you know, my goodness, I never thought about this. So every slide leading up to what I just talked about prepares you to think about these S-curves coming one right after another. all basically encapsulated in these risk categories of economic, environmental, geopolitical, social, and technological. And all of those are pieces that you have to understand about how do I develop and implement a strategy, both on a domestic basis, on an international basis, and on a global basis, that takes into account what I'm showing you on this chart. And I'm going to come back to that to say kind of what do I need to do inside my business to be able to grow the people that are capable of doing this. Given all of that, how do I build up the skills and the capabilities of people in my organization that actually can develop and implement a strategy that is not only responsive, but a strategy that is out in front of these various entanglements in the world that are going to affect your ability to create and capture value, which is what strategy is all about? What are the critical skills that I need for the whitewater world? And so what I have to do is understand that reading context is not easy. I have to shift from being able to read content to be able to read context. And so that means how do I skillfully read the currents and the disturbances of the context? And that the disturbances and the currents of the context gets to the point of how do I interpret the flows and what they reveal that lie beneath the surface? And then how do I leverage those for really what I call amplified action? So making it really simple, how do I read what are the rocks beneath the surface? What happens when the river goes narrow and the river goes wide? And once I can read all of those things, and that gets me back to the chart previously, how do I leverage those things for amplified action? And that is a huge shift in thinking. Because
can I ask a clarifying question? So some people might think of the difference between seeing content versus context as the difference between seeing the forest from the trees. Would you say that's a fair comparison?
It's a partial comparison.
Okay, say more about that.
A forest and the trees are basically just reading content and saying I can separate pieces of content from something that is kind of large and macro, mm-hmm, down to the tree, which is micro.
Right.
So that doesn't mean that I've read context at all. What I really need to understand for context is, am I even in the right forest? Mm. Okay. And that's a big, big difference. Mm. And then once I kind of understand, am I in the right forest, then I can begin interpreting what's going on inside that forest. So I take a look at that forest and I take a look at the forest and I can say, why does it have a huge amount of undergrowth in this forest? Well, maybe it's an old forest with a lot of undergrowth. And then I got to ask myself, you know, I'm thinking about clearing this forest off, deforestation, to plant crops. And if I plant crops, I'm going to be able to feed more people and create more employment. Oh, you know, but on the other hand, if I start taking away that forest and I plant crops, I'm going to basically increase the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere, and I'm not going to be doing the right thing for the planet. And so I've got to be able to balance those various what I'm going to call disturbances that are going on, and being able to understand basically, you know, how to interpret those and what kind of action I need to take, because I need to understand what I'm going to call this hyperconnectivity and the radical contingency of all these various points that I point out about managing risk in the world. Does that help you a little bit?
It sure does. Thank you.
So in order to do that in reading context, you got to ask, so, you know, what do I do? What do I need to look at? What are the fundamental aspects? Well, the fundamental aspects that I look at are, I want a business that's adaptable. I want a business that's resilient. And I want to be able to have a business that thrives in this ongoing kind of turbulence and disruption in my whitewater world. And when I consider the contextual framework, I have to remember that change, as I showed you with the S-curves, change is constant. Adaptability has to pay attention to all of these things I showed you before. But those things actually break down to a pretty basic model that we teach in global business and that we teach in strategy, and that is a PESTEL analysis, a political, economic, social, technological, that should be an E for environmental elements, to ensure that you are prepared for this ongoing turbulence and disruption. And so when I think about political, do you monitor the political landscape? Do you look for emerging trends and shifts in policy? Are you prepared for sudden regulatory changes? Are you prepared? Are you watching right now as a supply chain person like me? I'm taking a look at the various potential trade agreements that are going on all over the world. And today, seeing as we're on the eve of the ASEAN conference, what's going to be the change in that? And of course, we're taking a look now at the shifts in political stability that could impact your operations around the world. So that's one step. Economic, pretty much everybody stays informed about what's going on, about economic trends, inflation rates, currency fluctuations. And you have to have an organization that in the scenario that we talk about building, you have to be ready to adjust to economic downturns or economic booms. And you basically have a scenario that says, you know, how does each part of that scenario, which are your alternative futures, how do they play out in different economic terms? Right now, one of the things that I think is critical is the whole social cultural issue. Consumer behaviors are changing, values are changing, demographics are changing. How do we adapt our products? Right here in strategy is another word, Sue, you may have heard me use a lot. And that is culture trumps strategy every single time. And so when I think about inside an organization of fostering a corporate culture that's inclusive, flexible, capable, embracing change, if I don't have that kind of a culture, I will never be able to develop and implement a truly what I'm call adaptable, resilient strategy. Technology, everybody talks about this right now. And of course, with the exponential increase in computing power, people are now investing in technology that increase not only efficiency anymore, but they're increasing my agility and they're increasing my responsiveness. And just take a look at the various tools that you use every single day. And again, I like to use my smartphone because it's a platform. And when I put more and more apps on that, I've got more and more things I can do that make me more agile, that make me more responsive. Instead of having to have large servers anymore, I can basically have my servers managed for me by Amazon Web Services or yeah. Microsoft or Dell. And then I get this word called artificial intelligence. You know, how many of you today are using ChatGPT-4? In my classes right now, I'm basically saying, you know, I want you to use it. I want you to go ahead and make the investment for 3 months for the extra $20 a month. And I want you to be able to access large amounts of data. And I want to be able to use ChatGPT to become much more efficient and responsive and agile. And I want you to test it and I want you to play with it. But I want you to tell me you use it. I want you to be honest about it. And then we can all learn together. But the other point about technology is look at those S-curves. There's going to be a disruption, small to large, basically coming every 12 to 14 months to almost every industry. Okay. So by now, your head ought to be spinning a little bit more. And I'm going to go beyond the pestle analysis, and I'm going to talk about developing and implementing the strategy in the whitewater world. And when I think about doing that, these are the principles that I have for creating the strategy. Do you have in your organization people that are really embracing change? It's not an interruption to the norm, but that it is in fact the norm itself. And a strategy to create and capture value, it's not a rigid plan. It's really nothing more than a flexible framework. It allows for two big things. It allows for pivoting, and it allows really incredible amount for iteration. The second principle is, are you building for resilience? Can you withstand the shock? Now, part of it withstanding a shock, I always take a look at cash flow. Do I have the cash flow? Am I managing my cash flow? Am I managing my assets in a way that I can quickly exit some and enter others? And that means I have to have diversified revenue streams. I have to be able to get away from scalable efficiency to scalable learning. And that often means, as we found out during the pandemic, I needed redundant systems. For a supply chain person like me, I went from just in time to just in case. Yeah. And then coming back again to the point of culture trumps strategy every time, I want a strong company culture. But in that, Sue, I want to talk about culture in a way that you and I have briefly discussed, but most people forget. there is not one company culture. Everybody that tells you that, I want you to stand up and I want you to tell them, hell no.
Yeah.
Actually, three That's cultures right. in the company. Yeah. There is a management culture, there's an employee culture, and there's the one that everyone forgets about, there's a customer culture. And you need to understand how to bring those three together in order to have an organization that is aligned and could withstand the shocks, but is also an organization that is helping your customer do a better job with their customer. So as one of our marketing professors, M. Ron Curran says, he's absolutely right. It's all about the customer's customer. And if we have a culture that understands that each part of it, the management, the employee, and the customer culture are basically all out to protect themselves, then you have to understand how to get them aligned around a purpose that they don't want to protect themselves, but they in fact want to give the full energy they have to the company. And you asked Sue back in the beginning about, what did I learn in the Marine Corps? Well, I learned a lot in the Marine Corps, but one of the things that I did learn in the Marine Corps is there was in fact what I called a greater purpose. And we understood that purpose, whether we were in an infantry company, whether we were in the air wing, no matter where we understood that purpose. And even though we may have had a slightly different culture in the way we had to operate what we did, we understood our common purpose. And that really made us the powerful force that an elite unit can be, and then even an elite that a part of a company can be, in order to be on the kind of the tip of the spear where they're facing all the turbulence in their environment. And then you have to prioritize adaptability. And prioritizing adaptability, and I talked about architecture, flatter hierarchies, agile project management techniques, all the skills that we know and learn in business school, but we tend not to, as we become more rigid over time, we tend not to remember those. And we want to, of course, encourage experimentation and learn from failure. Everybody talks about those things, but not a lot of people practice them very well. And then probably that's why I put a heading into this particular presentation. We want to foster innovation, continuous innovation. I had the wonderful opportunity when I was working with the Fung Group to work with Clay Christensen before he passed away in the Christensen Institute. And we are a firm believer in disruptive innovation. New ideas are valued, tested, but the thing I took away from working with Clay was he had this wonderful plaque in his office, and it said, bring me the anomalies. The word bring me the anomalies was where the new ideas can be valued and tested, and then innovation, using innovation techniques, I could help kind of capitalize on that turbulence. That was a huge learning for me, and I just want to pass that on to everybody. So when I think about these different pieces, it comes down, Sue, to developing agile leadership, leveraging data and technology, cultivating a learning organization, engage with your stakeholders. And the outcome of all of this is a strategy that I call as fit for purpose. It survives and thrives in a whitewater world. It's a strategy that is all about creating and capturing value. And then when I think about that, I want to come down to my final point. So who are the kinds of people that I really have enjoyed over the years working with and building these kinds of organizations? And I call them, Sue, entrepreneurial learners. Now, that's different than being an entrepreneur. An entrepreneurial learner has to have a disposition. And the disposition that I like here is, think about Sherlock Holmes. You're always questing, you're always connecting, you're always probing. And look around your organization and say, who are the people that are doing this? Sometimes you really get angry with them because they're always asking questions. And they're out connecting dots, not only connecting dots, but I'll talk about in a minute, they're developing new dots. And then they're probing. And sometimes they're really challenging you. These people are deeply curious and they listen generatively. What do I mean by listen generatively? That means they continuously generate new ideas from listening to others. And by doing this, they always learn with and from others, and they read context. They understand, okay, I'm going to, first of all, ask the question, am I in the right forest? And then they reflect upon performance with the help of cohorts and other people, an ongoing reflection process. And I think about kind of Sherlock Holmes, and that is kind of the picture that I really like. And we've talked about up till now this combination in the mind of a Sherlock Holmes and a whitewater kayaker. And those are the kind of the two pieces I like to put together. And perhaps even more challenging, I want people, Sue, to operate in this whitewater world by what I call seeing for understanding. And they want to take a look at the things that are changed by connection. And as soon as I begin to go back to that, the chart that I showed earlier on connectivity from the World Economic Forum, then you can begin to see how things are changed by connection, and you can do a much better job of reading what's happening in the world. And so you can take these old operating frames that we had around efficiency, they're insufficient. We just need this new way to look at things. And I call it sense breaking for sense making. And here what John C. D. Brown tells me, it's not just connecting the dots, but adding the new what if dots to the mix. And to discover the unknown, or as I think was once said, the potentially knowable unknowns. And then you can speculate on alternative outcomes. And I want people to begin to learn how to play with these, Sue. And I think playing is really an important word. But I want you to use one more thing. I want you to think about using your imagination to speculate broadly on alternative futures. We all know about scenario planning. I teach it in my strategy classes. I've used it for years. When you do a good scenario, you come up with usually four really good alternative futures. And then from those alternative futures, I want you to use the things we talked about today to your imagination. Speculate broadly on the implications. And then I want to leave you with another word: escape the tyranny of the probable and its corollary incremental thinking through using imagination speculatively. So that, Sue, is kind of my core points about how you develop and innovate and lead in this whitewater world. And I'm happy to take any of your questions.
Sure. Leonard, thank you so much for teaching us. You know, that was really such a helpful overview. My first response to that is thinking about the importance of having a growth mindset. In any role within an organization, if we have that, you know, as Carol Dweck talked about, a fixed mindset where, you know, this is how I've always been and this is what I do, and that's it. You know, people are going to get stuck, right, and stay in their comfort zone. So this is about having a growth mindset from a leadership perspective. It also means, you know, creating, and I think we talked about this, psychological safety isn't, creating a fluff workplace for snowflakes, right? It's about making it acceptable with no consequence for people to take risks, make failures, make mistakes, voice opinions that be contrarians, in a respectful way, of course, right? Not to be disrespectful, but to express their different way of thinking and to explore different ways of thinking. So leadership's obligation is to make it welcoming and inclusive to do that, and to develop employees who may not have those capabilities or may not have flourished in environments, right? Whether it's school systems or perhaps even the kinds of roles that they're in. So to kind of foster that, whether people have the chance to go to business school, as we know, that's a gift and that not everybody gets to do, but organizations certainly can do that. So those were some of the things that came to mind, you know, from my perspective, from a leadership perspective. I would love to ask you to share with our audience a compare and contrast, an example of one organization that has done this really well and another organization that failed.
Oh, very good, Sue. But let me add one more thing to your fixed and growth mindset. So I would encourage everybody to read Satya Nadella's book from Microsoft, because that was a wonderful compare and contrast. And what he did is he took Microsoft from the desktop to the cloud. That was a huge switch. And he had to basically take an entire organization that had been very successful, that had operated under a Bill Gates and a Steve Ballmer with a certain type of mindset and a certain architecture. And it turned out to be, let's just make the desktop better and better and better. That's like a clipper ship adding one more mast and 10 more sails. I didn't do anything to make that clipper ship really much better. All I did was make it a little bit faster. But I didn't basically change the trajectory of power over the water. So then when I went to steam, that was a breakthrough.
Right? Yeah. Okay. That's creating a new dot,
I used technology to basically create a new dot, and then I connected, you know, everything I had in the old dot, what was in the hold of the clipper ship, how was I transporting tea, all the rest of that. I could create all that to the new dot and create a new business model. So what Satya Nadella did, which is a great example, is he took a fixed mindset. I'm going to make the desktop better, and recognize that there was a thing called the cloud. And he literally shifted Microsoft to the cloud, and not only did he shift it to the cloud, but he took the capabilities that he had that were being put into the desktop and figured out how to take those capabilities and move them so that technology would enable people to have a whole new set of opportunities to be able to take that technology and build the cloud. And then, of course, the new business model of the cloud, in fact, gives you a way to collect a huge amount of data from other people and makes you even better off. And so he went from a desktop to the cloud and from basically a hardware company to a data company.
And that's a really great reference.
It's a great example. So I urge people to read Satya and Nadella's book. It's a great example. It's probably a 2-hour read. And it's a wonderful thing because I'm a firm believer, as he is, by the way. And he told his people, we had the opportunity to listen to him a few years ago, as how many books he reads in a month. And he said one of the ways that he stays on top of what he does and where he gets different ideas is to basically read. And so I urge you to read Satya Nadella's book. But the other question that you raised about another good example, everybody knows this one. In fact, everybody listening to this knows this one. And that's, of course, Blockbuster versus Netflix. Okay, we teach that in class. It's a wonderful Harvard case. But the whole core of that case was Blockbuster saw an opportunity for us to not have to go to the movie theater and have a greater selection of movies to watch, or videos to watch and music to listen to by going to their store and selecting what you wanted. And so they put up, this is the wonderful gas station complex, you know, theory. You own the corners, and they own the corners, right? Huge investment, asset investment in brick and mortar to own the corners. And of course the investment to rent rent the videos. And then you and I went down and paid for them. And then it got a little bit better. We could put in our orders early and say which ones we wanted. If we didn't bring it back fast enough, you know, we got penalized. And that was a big problem. I forget how much it was, but when I didn't bring it back the right day, it charged me. Anyway, but that was kind of like the clipper ship. It kind of went from basically the old 3-masted schooner. They went to a clipper ship now, which it could sail, you know, could sail before the wind, and it had a lot more stuff in the hull, and it was on every corner. Okay. Now along comes Netflix, and they said, you know something, that model that Blockbuster has is asset heavy. How can I get you and I to be able to take a video and you don't have to go to the store and I don't have to have a store on every corner? And the answer was, you know something, I can have a few warehouses and I can deliver it to you. And that, of course, got, you know, they had, you know, they had, and now you had the FedEx and the UPS, you know, and by the way, the connection of having a FedEx and UPS has a Netflix enabled to do what it does. So here you have connecting some dots and creating a new dot, which was a new business model. And most people forget about that they had to have a FedEx and a UPS around to kind of make all this work.
That's true, yeah.
Okay. And then, you know, comes the internet. And the internet now allows me to order it in a way that was a whole lot faster. I can know it's on FedEx and UPS. I can know when it's going to be delivered to my house. And now all of a sudden, I don't need to go to Blockbuster. Well, Blockbuster, this was right in front of them. They could see it coming. And this is your fixed mindset, growth mindset. Blockbuster had a fixed mindset, but they also had one other problem. They had a huge investment in a heavy investment in the corners. And what most people forget about in this is, how long does it take you to exit that investment, that asset heavy investment, to get to the new model? And that's when you talked about earlier, maybe zero basing. One of the things that zero basing your business does, and we found it done very successfully in the fund group, is by zero basing it, it gave us money to invest in the new businesses. So Blockbuster, I wasn't sitting in their boardroom, but I've got to guess they didn't zero, they could see this coming, but they said, you know, it's going to take us too many years to get out of this, you know, asset heavy environment and duplicate what the Netflix is doing. And on top of that, they probably didn't zero base their business to get enough cash. And they took a look at their business, they were operating on thin enough margins that they didn't have enough cash flow to exit, to enter the new one. So Netflix already was way in front of them. Then Netflix is looking at the future. We ask you to look at technology and create some new dots. Well, they took a look at the value stream in their business. And the only part they were capturing was the part of showing the video to you. But where was all the money being made in the business? And when I do what I call value stream mapping, I take a look at the fact that, you know, the people making the money are the people making the content. And so Netflix took one look at that and said, suppose we control the content, we already control the distribution system. Now, we didn't know, I'm going to say you didn't know, streaming was already here. It's just, it wasn't kind of evenly distributed. But Netflix could see streaming coming. And they can see on the value chain that they wanted to move into content. And what do we replace the ordering system in their warehouse with? I created with the internet, which is streaming. And so I not only connected the dots, I created new dots with the technology. And that's a wonderful story. They were not afraid to cannibalize the old asset to get into the new one. And the best story I've ever heard about this, Sue, is one of my doctoral cohort companions. And he was the guy that invented the electronic cash register.
Oh, my. Wow.
Chris told an amazing story of how that came about. And that story holds true today for everybody listening to this. So they were three Fairchild engineers. They were in Boston. They were all electrical engineers. And they saw that they, in fact, could use a computer to take away all the kind of mechanical issues of the cash register. So they built a prototype, not a hardware prototype, but basically a cardboard prototype and some electronic stuff. They went to a venture capitalist in Boston, and the venture capitalist said, it's a great idea, but National Cash Register already has the electronic cash register in their lab. And so when they come out, they're going to blow you away. Well, my friend Fritz and his two friends drove to Akron, Ohio. I think he told me they actually drove in a Volkswagen van, but it didn't have a peace symbol on the side. And they took, and for those of you that listen to this that have ever been to Akron and or maybe grew up there, you could hear the NCR factory before you could see it. And they were big brick and mortar factories. So Fritz and his two friends went and took a picture of it, drove back to Boston, and they asked the venture capitalist, how many years do you think it's going to take NCR to write down the mechanical business? The venture capitalist was a pretty smart guy, and he said about 6 years, and then the light bulb went off. So Fritz and his two friends had a six-year head start to bring the electronic cash register in, because NCR couldn't write down their asset fast enough, even though they had it in the lab. And that was also the Kodak story in a way too. They had it in the lab. Kodak could have probably written down their asset, but they took the opposite. They basically took what I call the fixed mindset approach as opposed to the growth mindset approach, and thought they could make their current businesses better. But Fritz and his buddies brought that to market in a couple of years. And I will tell you that they made a bundle when they finally sold the patents to whoever bought that set of patents. But it was a fixed mindset versus a growth mindset, plus understanding the financial implication of your competitor and how fast they can exit a business, but add to that, you know, their understanding, their willingness to depart from that business. So that's a long answer to your short question, but there's three good examples.
No, those are great. And before we close, Leonard, I want to ask you a final question, which is comes to the punchline. If I'm a leader of an organization and I'm thinking, well, how do I start? You know, What recommendations do you have for business leaders, whether it's they've got a startup or they've got a multinational company? You know, what are, and obviously where you start depends on where you are so far, but yeah. Give us some things to think about that might be different for them to consider.
Well, let me talk to startup, because that is really different. Okay, so the startup is really different. And in a startup is all about making choices, right? And it's a choices about what to do and what not to do. And so the choices, there are four choices that I look at that actually come from some wonderful work at MIT that they've done in entrepreneurial strategy. And I use their book, literally all over the world, and we built models from it. Is the four choices are: choose your technology, choose your customer, choose your competitor, and what I call choose your identity and your organizational structure. So you've got to make those four choices. Okay. Then those four choices matter together, because you have to make a decision about where you're going to invest. Am I going to invest in competition or collaboration? And out of that, I can put together a two by two, which comes up with four entrepreneurial strategies to take those four pieces, put it together. And I've either got an intellectual property strategy, a value chain strategy, an architectural strategy, or a disruption strategy. Mm-hmm. And for an entrepreneur, go to entrepreneurial strategy, take a look at Aaron Scott and Stephen Gans at MIT. The book is there, and it wonderfully lays this out. And that's what I teach in the entrepreneurial strategy class here and in Israel. So that's kind of one way to look at it. Now, in terms of a going organization, and by the way, one part of the four choices, be really clear when it comes to what I talk about your identity and organization. Be really clear on the purpose, on the founder's purpose, and that all the rest of the founders are keyed into that one. And that the word purpose goes all the way across to the other organization. So when I think about that, I'm going to put it in two parts for you, Sue. I believe in a strategic process that starts with aspiration, and then and be really clear on that, and then gets, as you pointed out early, where to play, how to win, what are my capabilities, and what are my measurement systems? And that's an iterative process. I go down one and I continuously go back and iterate on that strategy. But the core of that strategy is recognize that strategy takes place in context. Strategy is the content. So now what's the context? Make sure I'm in the right forest before I go down that, all that stuff of planting the trees. And that means I have to think about the world as a whitewater world, that it's hyper-connected and it's radically contingent. It's a world that understand that it is entangled. It is complex, and that everything is connected. So my final advice is understand the whitewater world as context. And then with that context, you can begin to build a strategy that takes into account a clear aspiration, where to play, how to win, capabilities, and measurement systems, and do it in the framework of the principles that we've talked about today.
Well, thank you so much for that, Leonard. Thank you for sharing your wisdom. I feel like we've provided a really good strategy class almost for our listeners. So this has been a bit different and just a real learning experience for all of us. So thank you so much. If people wanted to reach out to you and connect, how might they do that?
Sue, you can reach me on my UCI email. And that's LLANE@UCI.edu.
Okay, thank you. And are you on LinkedIn as well?
I am also on LinkedIn, yes. And you can find me on LinkedIn.
Okay, terrific. Thank you so much, Leonard. And I hope that if people wanted to get a copy of your slides, if that might be possible as well.
And I'll put that together and get those to you in the next week or so.
Sounds good. Thank you so much. Okay. Well, thank you everybody for listening. This has been Tapping Wisdom, and I'm Sue Patternacht.